Good evening, Bethel Park, and welcome to Live Well Bethel Park Speaker Series. Tonight I have with me Detective Sean Gorman, who's been a Bethel Park cop for 15 years, John Bauer, who is a paramedic at tri-community South, and he has 42 years experience in the field, and we have Alan Cabin from Gateway Rehab. He has 10 years experience in the rehab field. So welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
We're gonna get into, you know, addiction. What's the cost of it to the person doing it, the family, the everything? I mean, it's a very important subject that's, you know, hopefully gets better here soon. So take it away.
The disease of addiction is a family disease. It affects every aspect of the family. It affects the relationships. It affects the trust. And it just creates a dynamic within the family that many people don't know how to handle. Sometimes they think what's appropriate turns out to be inappropriate, and that's where people working in the field of drug and alcohol are able to educate people on what seems logical really isn't going to produce the outcomes that most family members would want in these types of situations.
Okay. Has the pandemic created more addiction, or is it getting better?
What I've read recently is that it's starting to grow again during the COVID pandemic. I could tell you that just our beds are full, and beds throughout the area of the other the rehabs besides Gateway Rehab also are seeing numbers growing. Unfortunately.
John, what have you seen being a paramedic for this long?
Well, it kind of goes in cycles. We've only had 3 overdoses so far this year. But when we're having overdoses, it seems like there's a bad batch out there, and the other communities are also having overdoses too. And the overdose age range is not what you would think. We've had 65-year-old grandmothers that have overdosed on heroin, and 20-year-old people. So it runs the gamut. It's not what you would think is the typical young male that would be doing it. It covers the whole age group.
That's, wow. Because I was thinking teenagers, 20s, maybe into your 30s.
Yeah, but and we could tell we're having a lot of them, and we notice that in the surrounding communities, like I said, they're having them too because there's a bad batch out there.
And then you always hear the Allegheny County Police or someone from your district attorney say on TV saying there's a bad batch, everyone needs to watch out for it, and that's
right.
A shame.
Right.
Sean, what have you seen over the years?
Well, just like John said, it's comes in waves. We have times where, obviously, years ago when we first started seeing heroin become prevalent, it was mostly young males, and it has now spanned the gamut, all ages and genders. It doesn't discriminate when it comes to opioid addiction, or any addiction really, but with opioids, obviously, as Alan can probably speak to, that a lot of times it's starting with legitimate medication prescriptions that is turning into addiction. We see that often. It's not too often that somebody's picking up a syringe and starting heroin for the first time. It's usually stemming from an existing injury, a surgery or something, causing an opioid addiction. So we are definitely seeing, as John said, we'll see spikes in it based on an increase in fentanyl being mixed in with the heroin. And I think that's one of the big issues is the not knowing the makeup of the drugs that people are using and finding other synthetics and fentanyl being incorporated into some of these drugs that are causing a higher amount of overdoses.
Is there one drug addiction that's worse? Is it heroin, opioids, alcohol? The beat is what I'm asking.
Not that we see. We treat all addictions the same. So there's some addictions where patients, if they're fortunate enough to come to a facility, have to go through detox. There's other drugs that people are using that they don't need to detox, and they go straight into a treatment program. But okay. I like what you said here about how this all begins. A lot of times, you'd be very, very surprised. People will go to the dentist or go to a family physician, and they're in a lot of pain, and they will give them a pretty strong opioid pain medication, even at small amounts. And then the next thing you know, they're coming back for a refill one time, which again, nothing to be alarmed about usually, but the next thing you know after that, they're starting to act in different ways, and you start seeing people who normally don't act in this certain way, but they start manipulating, they start lying, they start looking for things. Before you know it, they're searching for the drugs on the street. And that's the scary thing about addiction, is that you really don't know that you have the propensity to be an addict until after you take it. I'm a certified recovery specialist, and everyone who's a certified recovery specialist is in recovery. So my example, my life there, things were fine. You know, I grew up in the 60s. We just started smoking pot and stuff. I'm 60s, we all started doing that. And then next thing you know, you start doing a little bit more. You go somewhere, you try this, you try that, some stronger drugs, and next thing you know, you're wondering why you're thinking about this all the time, and why you're searching for it and seeking it and doing more and more gradually over a period of time.
Okay, now you brought up marijuana. Is that, some people say it's a gateway drug, other people are like, no, it's not. What is it? I mean, is it a gateway drug?
I know people start on marijuana, and I know people never touched the stuff, and just also their addiction grew. So
and some people just stay on marijuana, and that's it, and their addiction doesn't grow.
Some people can do that, and that's the thing. Like the group I hung around with, you know, as I was going on and on, they were smoking. Like we would go to high school, and then usually after high school, like the bunch of us would go to college. My friends started like using less and studying harder. I unfortunately chose to do more and more drugs and do less studying. Next thing I know, I'm not going to school anymore. They're going to school, they're graduating, they have relationships going on, making plans to go marry, go to grad school and stuff like that. That's the people in a 12-step program, the fellowship of like Narcotics Anonymous and Alcoholics Anonymous defined this drug, the addiction, as cunning, baffling, and powerful. And I think that wraps it up really succinctly and really, really well.
It does. More, when you're in the hospital, you talked about opioids, but can morphine start you down that road too? Because, you know, if you had surgery, they give you the morphine drip button, and, you know, when you have pain, they tell you hit it, you know. Is that powerful enough to start you down the same road?
Well, I'm a recovery specialist. I'm not a a therapist or a physician there. Okay. But what I see just in my interaction with people who suffer from this terrible disease is that anything can start that trigger going on there. You never know.
Okay, John, what have you seen over the years? I mean. Well, causing more accidents, is it alcohol or is it other drugs?
I think it's more alcohol, but what we see is how it affects the family members. We have seen in the past repeat overdoses with the same person, and the how it affects the family, how the family reacts. And we have a lot of family members that when that happens, they have Narcan at their house. And they administer the Narcan to the person right when they notice the overdose. And usually by the time we get there, they're awake and talking. So it's rough on the family, and I've seen families that are so supportive of it, and then families that have just had enough and said, that's it, I'm not doing anything more. It's a terrible thing, and it affects not only the person that's addicted, but the family members too.
I grew up in the inner city, and I've seen families with mostly alcohol addiction when I was a kid, and it was like, it just ripped them apart. It was like, and I was like, how can this thing take a hold of you? Didn't understand it, you know. It was just, it was bare, Kadasan, you know.
Yeah. And like we said, it crosses all boundaries. It's the husband that had fentanyl patches because he had an injury, and he went on from there to, like I said, the 65-year-old grandmother to the young kid who's trying it for the first times. It touches everybody.
Well, Sean, I'm assuming addiction drives up crime rates at some point because of just the nature of it. They're probably not working.
It depends. There's functional addicts, depending on what drug you're talking about. But obviously, yes, for us on our end, on law enforcement, we see, you know, anything from theft crimes to domestic violence assaults that are rooted in, you know, addiction or mental health or a combination of the both. And as Alan mentioned about an increase in these cases during COVID, that was a prime example of what the pandemic did to people that were already vulnerable or already struggling with addiction or struggling with mental health, and all of a sudden you have lockdowns or you have people not going to work or social situations being cut off that might have been, you know, beneficial to them, and they turn to, you know, pills, bottle, something else as a coping for it. So we definitely saw a rise during the pandemic in domestic-related incidents because people are now stuck at home with each other, and tensions start growing. And a lot of those had some alcohol or mental health component. With heroin addiction, we see a lot of our retail thefts in our shopping areas, as well as burglaries and thefts from vehicles, being rooted heavily in opioid addiction. Usually, that's the thefts are being perpetrated to sell for money to support that habit.
Okay. And you know, everyone always says, "Oh, it doesn't affect me." I'm like, because it is in our family, but it does. It affects retail prices. It affects, you know, strain on the legal system, everything. It affects each and every one of us, and that's, I think, a lot of people got to realize that, you know, we're all in this together. Because if we don't, we're not going to, we've been in the war on drugs since the 80s when Reagan coined the term, and I'm like, but we're not winning it. What are we, is there a better solution? You know, and it's not, hey, let's legalize everything, because that's not a good solution to it.
I think education and awareness, rehabilitation services being much more broadly available. On our end, court interventions where we can divert people into programs where they can seek treatment as opposed to punishment. And, you know, I think that awareness that has come about has definitely increased the support for it.
A good thing we have is St. Clair has a program. If we take somebody that has an addiction problem to St. Clair, and if they're agreeable to it, they call Gateway, and a recovery specialist will come to the emergency room and meet with the person and talk with them. And if they're willing, we'll take them to a rehab center right from the emergency room and start them on the path. And that's been a good thing, and it's a good tool we can provide to people with addiction.
That's a great tool we can provide people with addiction.
We've had that relationship with St. Clair for, I think, the beginning of the third year. I apologize if I'm wrong on those numbers, but I think it's the start of our third year of partnership, and St. Clair came to us. St. Clair came to Gateway in realizing that, especially in the emergency room, they kept on saying the same patients over and over and over again. And all they could do back then was to kind of stabilize them, hydrate them, maybe give them some comfort measures until they're well enough to be released from emergency room, and we give them a number to call. And I remember the first time we had a meeting with them, We sat down and they told us what they saw and what they wanted to stop there. And they said, we could give that piece of paper to the patient, and before they even walked out the door, they tore it up and they could see them just throwing in there. So they reached out to us to see, can we do something better? Because we're not serving this population very well. So kudos to them for doing that. And we have a full-time CRS there, Joe, who I'm filling in for tonight. And she's there full-time Monday through Friday. And then after hours from like 5 o'clock in the evening until she returns in the morning and all the way through the weekend, we have a couple people on our CRS team who go and are on call. They stay by the phone, and then we can do a lot of things over the phone. And if need be, we come in even 2, 3, 4 in the morning there, because sometimes it gets a little chaotic, and we really need somebody come in there that can talk to them as a peer. And that's one thing. There's things that we could work with the patients on that the nurses and the doctors just can't. They don't understand that disease. We have that lived experience, and we could talk to them on their own terms, and they find that very beneficial. Sometimes that's the only way to really get them to really start talking and feel comfortable talking.
I can say that, because if you don't know what it does to you, you don't kind of live that life, how can you really talk to somebody about it? I mean,
yeah, and if Sean says something or if I say something, it's we're lecturing.
Yeah.
We're lecturing this person about their addiction and what it's doing to their family and everything. But if somebody that's gone through it goes through the process, and it's a lot easier. I mean, we used to have little cards that we still have them that we can give to them that refer them to numerous places, but that's just a card. And like he said, they're going to look at that and throw that card away.
That would be typical behavior, because we do it with coupons or whatever. We're all, I'm sorry, I don't need that.
Yeah,
it's just human nature.
Okay. One of the challenges I think that we face along with EMS with responding to overdoses and Narcan administration, it's a great medication for stopping an opioid overdose, but I know we've had cases where we show up, the person is now alert and oriented after the Narcan, and they want nothing to do with EMS or police, and they end up refusing to go to the hospital against medical advice, and sometimes they end up overdosing later that same day, or, you know, the Narcan doesn't take away the complete effects of the opioid. If they took enough of it, they could re-overdose after we leave and have to respond again. And the downside of not having them go to a hospital where they can have that intervention is they're treated and they're released back to the house, and you know, we leave the scene, and unfortunately, you know, they might choose to
do it again.
Yeah.
Do you spare some being angry when you show up and give them that Narcan at times?
It depends. I've seen both. Yeah. Most of the time they're mostly out of it, and I think John's learned, and you kind of learn after a while that, you know, giving the dose slowly, monitoring, brings them out of it slowly, versus hitting them with a bunch of Narcan and all of a sudden they are wide awake and then could potentially become violent. You know, we've had the knockdown drag out fights, but you know, a lot of times that people are, you know, disoriented and
they're in denial. They deny.
Sure, right.
They're sitting next to drug paraphernalia, but they deny they took it. Yeah.
Or the family members or friends at the scene are hiding the paraphernalia or the drugs before our arrival. Okay. So it's harder for us and the medics to be able to say, well, what did you take? Because we can't find, you know, if we find the pill bottle, we can say, well, we know exactly what this medication might do and how to medically treat it. Unfortunately, that makes it hard.
Unfortunately, the people that are with them are thinking, oh, we don't want them to go to jail right away. Isn't there hiding?
And they won't. With the way the laws are written now, and the Good Samaritan laws that are built in, someone who calls in an overdose to 911 and provides all their information, stays with the patient, and is a good witness and does everything legally necessary, they are immune from prosecution for, you know, any type of possession of drug or paraphernalia. Obviously, if they're the one dealing or supplying or there's a major issue, that's different. But that law was put into effect to try to encourage people to call in for medical help instead of being afraid of, hey, the cops are going to show up and they're going to be in trouble. Right. You know, if you do everything right by the book and you stay with the person and get them help, then you're not going to be in legal trouble.
Well, that's a very good idea, because I remember high school parties, college parties, also, oh, man, you hear the sirens and everyone's running, and you know, we've had a couple kids tragically, you know, from alcohol, just however it happened, you know, they died from drinking too much. And everyone ran. It was like, I'm not getting in trouble. You're on your own. And that's, I think that's a good tactic of saying, no, stay and help us save this person's life.
It's a trade-off. We want people to call when help is needed, because our officers are equipped with Narcan. Obviously, the medics are too. So our first priority is to, you know, help and preserve life. Before we take on, you know, our law enforcement role. But, you know, there's the drawbacks of, you know, someone does get resuscitated, they don't go to the hospital, or even if they do, we then can't, there's no legal ramifications that we can put any type of oversight on. Hey, you have a court date, and maybe the courts can get involved with rehab facilities, right, and kind of encourage that. That's one thing we do lose with the way the law's written. We don't have any type of authority or encouragement to direct help.
Is there anything that we can do at a younger age with kids? You know, when I grew up 70s and 80s, you know, we had drug week in school, you know, and everyone was like, you looked at the people like, you're crazy, because they just came in and lectured. They didn't give you illustrations. They didn't do anything else. Is there something we can do to get the young kids' attention and say, look, this is going to start you down a road that you don't want to go down?
I think it comes down to education. I think most of the problems and the ways we can deal with it comes with education and love. You know, just recently, that's about 2 or 3 weeks ago, I was asked to go and speak at a neighborhood school, a bunch of 10th graders. And the only thing that I can really do that I think is effective is just to share my experience, strength, and hope. Because you know, I used to be one of those people out there running and lying and using and causing all kinds of insanity in my life, not in my life, but life of my wife and my friends, my employer, everybody. It was because we got to realize that when somebody's caught in the grips of addiction, there's only one thing they think about, honestly, every time they get up in the morning, and that's it. You know, how am I going to get what I want? And when can I get it? That they don't think of those things that, even if you have a son or a daughter or something like that, they're not thinking about that. When I was in my active addiction, I didn't think about that. I would say the right things to just sort of pacify everybody. I said all the right things, but my behaviors, I would just be going out, just focusing on the drug. In fact, my wife at one point thought I was having an affair. And in essence, I did. I was having an affair with my addiction, my drugs.
That's a unique way to look at it. Now you say it like that.
What was your drug?
I could honestly say I never said no. But what brought me into rehab was crack cocaine. That's the one that took me down big time.
Yeah, that's.
But from the time I started using drugs till time I got into the treatment, I can honestly tell you, I never said no. I didn't even ask them what it was half the time.
I remember that campaign, just say no, and that's like all it was. And I was like, well, yeah, but as a kid, you're going, why am I saying no? You know, you want that explanation, and they weren't giving it to you.
No. Well, that's what I wanted. My active addiction, that's what I wanted. I wanted to get somewhere else. I never wanted to be there and dealing with everything that you have to deal with in life. When I was caught in the grips of my addiction, that's all I want to do is be somewhere else. And the drugs are the things that could get me there.
A friend of mine owned a business, and his one employee was a recovering heroin addict. And we started talking one day, and he's like, I'm like, why did you do it? He said, the first time is the greatest high you ever have. He said, and the second time it becomes less and less, but now you're so addictive, you're chasing it. Oh, it'll be this time, it'll be this time. He said, you know, you're thinking about it 24/7, and
right,
pacifying the people around you.
Right. And one of the things we've got to deal with when we're trying to help people seeking recovery is to realize that how much, not only did they lie and steal from families and everything, but they deceive themselves. This disease is so powerful that literally you'll be deceiving yourself. It'll be telling you things in your head that are not true, but when you're caught in those grips, you'll believe that. You will believe that.
Wow.
Yeah, it's a very deadly disease. I really and a very powerful disease. Sometimes it can be real subtle, you know, and you think everything's okay. There were like weekends there where I said, "Oh, I didn't have a problem," because came a point in my time in my life where people say, "I think I got a problem," right? And so, you know, I would quit for a couple of days, and the weekend I'd take a weekend off, wouldn't get higher thing. I'd say, "Now, come Monday," I said, "Okay, I don't have a problem, right? I have a problem," and then I go gangbusters starting on Monday, and eventually got to the point where I could never stop. I couldn't go a day without using.
Okay, so maybe my theory of saying, "Hey, really." Tied it on this week and I'm done for 2 months isn't so good. You got to watch it a little differently.
Yeah, that's why people need to get help. That's why people need to get assessed at the closest rehab that near their homes. That's where they need to, you know, go and get treatment by professionals who know how to treat this their addiction. I, along with everybody on our CRS team and all the other people out there in recovery, what we don't see in the community and on the news and stuff like that, we know what an addict looks like, or we think we know what an addict looks like. We see that. We know what that looks like. But the face of recovery, of recovering addicts, not too many people are familiar with that. And I think we really need to get that message out. I think we need to get people visible out there. And that's the beauty about being about CRS. Not only can we go and help the sick and suffering who are still out there, okay? But, you know, we can show people that, hey, I was like this guy one time. People do recover. If they go get the help and they have that desire to want to get well, treatment does work and people get better.
We see the addicts and we think we know what an addict looks like because the way it's depicted on TV, yeah. You know. They're always on, for lack of a better term, skid row and, you know, long hair, haven't bathed in a while. And that's not true. I mean, a lot of them are functioning. You probably, if you didn't know them well, you wouldn't know they were an addict. You know, you could work with somebody and they're an addict. You'd miss it because
they're functioning. We see, like I said, the gambit. Right. Family, fathers, mothers that are addicted and they're functioning with their family and until that one time when they overdose, and that's how the family finds out that they're an addicted person.
It's unfortunate it takes that or probably an auto accident or something along that lines for someone to go, yeah, they do have a problem. And that's, I'm gonna ask you too, Sean and John, do you see like when an addict's in an accident, all of a sudden it's like an epiphany, like I gotta get help, does that push them? No?
No.
No.
A good point Sean made about was the police with the Narcan. Our police all carry Narcan, and a lot of times they get there before we do because they're out driving around the road and we're coming from our station, and they administer the Narcan before we get there. And by the time we get there, the person's already starting to come out of the
overdose.
And family members. There's a lot of family members out there that have Narcan, and it's readily available at every pharmacy. And the state medical director wrote a prescription, so you don't need a prescription for Narcan. You can go into any pharmacy and request Narcan and get Narcan. So he wrote a statewide prescription for any pharmacist to...
If I go and say I need it for...
You can go in any pharmacy and get Narcan.
That's a valuable piece of information I never knew about. And I'll say this, I like doing this series because every time we do something, I learned from him a couple things about accidents when the ambulances, when we're talking about living well at home. I just learned that. I didn't know anyone could go get Narcan.
Yeah. Anybody can get it at any pharmacy and have it at their house.
That's it. it's a good thing for an unfortunate circumstance.
Right.
And I will say our police do well with not just the helping people with the addiction, but I had to go to the emergency room in the middle of the night, and an officer was the first one there, and very professional, very calm me and my wife down, and, you know, said to my son, everything's going to be all right. You know, you got this little kid looking at you, and the lights are outside, and they're panicked. But they, you guys do a tremendous
job. We're very fortunate with the police officers we have. They're very helpful, yeah. And they do a great job.
Yeah, they do.
And when talking about the Narcan use, we actually pulled some stats just the last 6 years or so as far as our Narcan use. When things started ramping up, and Narcan actually started being issued to officers. In 2016, we only administered it 3 times. In 2017, 14 times. So the use of it started going up because we were encountering more overdoses and we had the tools to administer. Now, these are officers, not medics. Yeah. These are just officers administering the Narcan prior to EMS arrival. 2018, it went down to 11. 2019, down to 8. 2020, it went up to 18 administrations. But last year, when they started allowing people to carry it and go to the pharmacy and get it free, we only had 2 administrations, because on a lot of these overdose calls, we would show up and a family member or friend had already administered it.
Yeah.
So there was no need for us to. Yeah. And which is great, although the downside could potentially be that we're not getting accurate statistics on overdoses because they're never calling for help, because they're just giving the Narcan, the person wakes up, and then they go about their day. So right. We're not even being notified.
Right. Right. So those 3 I was talking about were 3 we responded to. Who knows, like Sean said, how many other overdoses had occurred. Narcan was given by somebody and they never called.
I could see that too, going back to the point of the Good Samaritan Act, that people don't know about it, so they're not going to call. You know, I'm not going to get called. We just won't call them. They'll be okay.
Yeah.
And a lot of times, they're not. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a lot of good techniques out there now, but, you know, the consequences is if we don't get the information out to the people, we're still, you know, like you're in high school. Police are coming, go. You know, mm-hmm. The kid that was having a party, you know, you're the one getting in trouble. We're out of here, guy.
Right. And all our CRSs carry Narcan with them. They've been trained and readily available. In fact, we just replaced everyone's because it was getting close to the expiration date. So, you know, we carry them around with us all the time because you never know.
How long does a can of, or I don't even know what it is, can, bottle?
Well, it comes in a
nasal spray,
a syringe that you inject nasally.
Okay.
So, some manufacturers have it different ways depending on which manufacturer you get. But essentially, it comes in a syringe with a nebulized tip that when you push the Narcan, it nebulizes it into the air and gets absorbed into mucosa of the nose and goes into the bloodstream. So it depends on which manufacturer. It might have a little different packaging or a little different syringe, but it all works the same.
See, when you talked about syringe before, I was under the misapprehension. There's a needle involved, I'm thinking.
No.
Where do you stick this needle? But no, okay, that does make sense. Get it in the bloodstream quicker through the...
Back in the day, that was the only thing that was available for like a long time until they developed the intranasal dosage form, which makes a lot easier for everybody.
We used to have to start an IV and then give it through the IV, but now we can just give it straight into the nose.
That's a good thing, because I could see a lot of people, even if they got to, you know, use a needle going, if I do this wrong, am I going to kill them if I do it wrong?
I think John's probably seen it too. With the Narcan usage, we're seeing that we're using more vials of Narcan on single calls due to the increase in fentanyl and other synthetic drugs that are incorporated in the heroin. So even though it's one Narcan usage, that one call, the officers and medics might have given 4 vials of Narcan as opposed to 1.
Yeah.
So some of the stronger, the potency of the street drugs is high enough that it's requiring multiple doses for the person to start
breathing,
becoming conscious and breathing.
Because a lot of times when we get there for the overdose, they're not breathing.
No.
And we need to get that going.
I think it gets, speaking of depicted wrong on TV too, because it's like a little spray or whatever, and they're up and they're normal. And that's from what you two have experienced, that's far from normal.
Yeah, it depends. Like Sean said, we've had to give multiple doses to get the person to a point where they're awake and they're able to talk. Where it used to be we could give one dose and that was good. Now sometimes we have to give multiples and just to get them breathing and stable.
And I can see why the people that deal with are putting the fentanyl and everything else in it, because now they, if they hook you, they may have you for life. You know, that's their livelihood.
Sean, are you seeing vaping problems?
We've had vaping problems, I'd say, for the last couple of years in our juvenile population in the schools. What used to be smoking in the bathroom, cigarettes are long out because they're unhealthy, and everybody's learned that smoking is an unhealthy habit. But vaping, which, you know, I know you're looking like it's why you'd say it. I tend to agree with you, because there's even different risks to vaping than traditional smoking, but it's easier to conceal, easier to hide,
and it's easy to put a drug into the vape to use it.
Oh, but that's a good point.
Yeah, and so legal medicinal marijuana users have, you know, THC vapes that are the same vape pen you could use for a tobacco product, you can use for that, which, you know, they're legally able to do, and that's one way to ingest it. Unfortunately, it's also sold, you know, to our juveniles, and it's a lot harder to detect because it doesn't have your traditional odor. You know, oftentimes you'll have to send it to a lab or have some additional information to confirm that, you know, it's a narcotic versus.
We've had several cases of juveniles that have vaped, and their friend had given them something to vape and told it was marijuana, but who knows what was in that when they gave them to vape it, and it's just, you don't know. So
I remember when my son, we were coming back from camp, and he was going into Neil Armstrong, and I started talking to him about drug use, and my wife's looking at me in the car like, what are you doing? And I said, Michelle, 2 weeks ago in the city, this kid took in what he thought was candy, gave it to some classmates, and the kid overdosed. You know, you got to start telling them, hey, look, if someone gives you something that isn't wrapped up, or it's a kid, just don't eat
it. The younger they learn, the better it is.
Yeah. And, you know, back when we were kids, don't talk to them about it, leave alone. They, you know, if they don't know it exists, then they're better off, and that's not the truth.
No.
Comes back to the education.
Yeah. Anyway,
the sooner we start educating the kids, the better I think we can just give them an understanding on what they need to do when they get into certain situations.
John, what are you seeing with vaping? Is there?
Well, we had several incidents with juveniles that had vaped and what they thought was marijuana, but they didn't know what was in. Who knows if it was marijuana or what it was. And they all had rapid heart rates. They had trouble breathing. They were shaky. And it was right after they vaped.
The technology is good, but going to this stuff is making your job harder to detect what it is and getting them the help they're going to need.
Right.
Because now you vape once and there's something in it and you don't detect it, and all of a sudden you're trying to chase that again, unfortunately. Is there other things in vaping? You know, does it damage the lungs? Does it?
Well, there's a lot of studies out right now about vaping, and they're trying to find out what damage it could cause or does cause. So I guess it's unknown right now.
The state has actually come in, because now with it being medically legal, they now have an Office of Medical Marijuana Policy and Oversight, and they're banning and recalling some of these tobacco vapes that contain certain flavors or chemicals in them that are causing, that have now been linked to popcorn lung, other medical stuff, and they're saying a lot of these flavored tobaccos, because, you know, people that were smoking, especially back in the day, I mean, Pall Malls and Marlboros didn't taste too good the first time you tried them. Now they're flavoring them. So for a high school kid, well, this is a great flavored tobacco product. It's cherry flavored. So they're making it more desirable. And the trade-off is it initially was marketed as, you know, it's safer than smoking tobacco. But now they're putting flavor additives and chemicals and fillers in them that are causing just as much, if not more, harm to lungs, right, especially young lungs.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, and Pall Malls and that back in the day didn't smoke it when someone was smoking by you either.
No, exactly.
It's like, get that away from me. Oh,
the vaping industry was out ahead of this way before the government. This was going for years before they even decided to start looking at it and seeing the dangers involved in that. Well, so they're catching up.
Yeah, that's kind of with everything, like even technology, you know. The industry gets out in front and the government has to catch up on. Unfortunately, that's the way it is. Look at, you know, cyber crimes, you know, for catching
up. Everything's reactionary. Yeah. Specifically opioids now. We're feeling the effects now, 20 or 30 years later, of over-prescribing in pharmaceuticals, 80s and 90s, where it was being handed out and portrayed to doctors as...
Oh, this is safe.
As a safe product to give to your patients.
Non-addictive.
Non-addictive. They were telling the doctors that.
And that was a criteria in medicine, that you ask the patient their pain scale.
Yeah.
And Medicare was basing payments on whether you were treating their pain and how you were managing a person's pain.
Right. Before I got into drug and alcohol, I worked in pharmacy for about 20-some years. So what these gentlemen are saying is exactly right. You go in there every day, a nurse would come in every day, what's your pain level at, stuff like that. And there was pressure on them to you know, if it got above a certain level, you have to provide them, offer them medication, stuff like that, because they didn't want the people to be in pain. People didn't like be in pain, and they were very attentive to it. So they did that, took care of the immediate need, but then again, afterwards, who knows what caused that. Some people...
I remember I had surgery, and... What's your pain level? What's your pain level?
Right.
I'm like, can I have, you know, two Tylenol? Oh, just use the morphine button. I'm not in that much pain. I argue with the nurses. Finally, I said to the doctor, he come in. I'm like, doc, can I just get Tylenol instead? I don't need that. And, you know, I explained about my mom's three half brothers, and I said, I'm scared to take in too much morphine.
Yeah.
I don't want to come out of here and be an addict, you know.
You'd be surprised how many people who are in recovery. You know, things show up. You know, just because you're in recovery doesn't mean you don't have illnesses. You don't have to have surgeries and stuff like that. But what we need to do as recovering addicts is to inform our doctor that don't even offer me any narcotics whatsoever there. Yeah. But you'd be surprised if you go to maybe a specialist who doesn't really know you, and you're going in for a surgery and stuff like that, or maybe post-surgery, come in there. And they'll start writing the Oxycontin out there, or the Vicodin's out right for you, and get right handed to you. So, you know, and we literally, we have to guard ourselves and tell the doctor, no, I'm in recovery. Right. Mm-hmm. You can't do that stuff. It's again, the education is even needed within the medical profession and physicians. Yeah. And that's something that the 12-step programs do. They actually do, we do have, like in Narcotics Anonymous, we actually go out. And when we're asked to, we can go out and talk to nurses and talk to nursing students. I've gone to talk to nursing students sometimes at the school, and as well as physicians, and to educate them, because the education they get about addiction is great.
Yeah.
And there's a dire need to increase that.
Companies are chasing the profit, you know. And the end result of chasing a profit sometimes causes greater consequences to our society than the intended good use of, you know, a drug. I mean, I'm always leery about, you're giving me what, and what can it do? Because I'm more scared of winding up an addict than anything.
That's the point. You have to take charge of your medical care.
Right.
You have to be an advocate or have some advocate for you to know what you're taking, what they're doing, and why they're doing it. So you have to watch that.
Yeah.
You have to let your PCP know if you're in recovery. I'm a recovering addict, I'm a recovering alcoholic. They need to know that.
And you, if you go in for surgery, the team that's going to operate, the hospital needs to know, or at the emergency room.
Right.
Now, there's a tricky situation. You have someone's an addict, but they were in a car accident or something. You know, they don't say anything because they want the pain to be alleviated. It's going to start them down that.
It could.
It could start them down that bad road again.
Yeah, there are situations where it's necessary, whether there's no other options there. I know in a 12-step fellowship, there's a way of doing things. We usually are instructed, okay, if you have to take pain medications, give it to somebody else in your family. Give it to a next door neighbor. You don't handle that. And when it's time for you to get a medication, you get it every 6 hours. You know, we would take it every 2 hours. Every 6 hours, then you know your mother, or your wife, or husband, or something like that. They would be in charge of that. And I remember one time I did have to take some, and I told my wife, you know, hide this really well, and just you know, I'm supposed to get every 6 hours. Just ask me. And eventually, over time, I didn't even need it as often as that. I was able to. I was very mindful. Very mindful. I lived enough number of years in active addiction. I know what that stuff can do to me, so I got to be very mindful. If I don't really need it, if I'm on the edge, you know, like I said, maybe I'll take a Motrin instead or something like that.
Well, we've gone into houses where all the medicines were locked in a safe, and because there was a possibility of addiction in the family or some member.
Wow.
So one family member had all the medicines locked up and would get the medicines out and administer them, so they couldn't go and get medicines.
Well, that's whatever it takes.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I agree with that because I've seen it firsthand, and you know, I can't imagine going down that road. That's just something that I never wanted to get on. I've seen, growing up where I grew up, a lot of talent, athletic-wise and even brain-wise, just. In high school, going, man, you're wasting this great opportunity and you can't see it.
Yeah.
You know? And that always just stuck with me.
That of all the cases, I know we all have our cases we remember or yeah. patients that we dealt with on a regular basis. And one of my most memorable was a gentleman who was a college athlete, was a scholarship baseball player, pitcher, injured his shoulder. From playing sports, and the team doctors started writing prescriptions for painkillers just to get him up on the mound, to get him playing game after game. He was their talent. He needed to be up there.
Right.
And unfortunately, once he finished school, there's no team doctor anymore, and now he has a full-blown addiction.
Yeah.
And someone tells him, hey, you can buy heroin to get you through when the doctors won't write you scripts. And someone who was an educated, talented person just fell very rapidly into heavy street drug use and unfortunately passed away, you know, in a short period of time. But I just remember conversations with that person, and they had aspirations of going back for their master. They really wanted to do something big, and unfortunately, you know, something as simple as a sports injury and
starts you down there.
Doctors or other people that push legitimate medication in illegitimate ways or too much.
And that kind of goes back to, I hate to say it, but the money. Get them back out there so we got the people coming in to generate the revenue to afford whatever that college needed to afford the scholarships, you know.
I think that attitude is slowly changing.
It should be. And the NFL, I like what they're doing to concussion protocol. It's got to be an independent, someone not associated with the team, because that's, you know, that's,
yeah.
We ignored that for long, and we ignored, you know,
this pain. Drug problem we've ignored for a lot of years, too.
Well, yeah, and managing the pain level. Well, that's not thinking about it, that's not a good approach, because, you know, if you got a morphine drip, well, they give you the controller. Well, if you feel pain, what's your tolerance for pain, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then people start doing this.
And people's tolerances are a lot different.
Yeah.
We generally ask people on a pain scale 1 to 10 what their pain level is. And sometimes people say 15, and they're talking to you like they're normal conversation, and they don't appear to be in any pain whatsoever. But they're saying the pain is 15. And then we'll have people that had a pretty serious injury, and we ask them if they want something for pain, and they'll say no. So it just runs the gamut.
It does. My dad had a high tolerance for our pain level when we played sports. Doesn't hurt. Don't worry about it. We did. Unfortunately, we didn't, just shrug it off. Since we're getting closer, what is the one takeaway, the biggest way you think we can prevent it?
Like Alan said, I think it's education. We need to educate people on what addiction does and how it affects people and what happens when you're addicted.
And not just the person addicted, I think the family.
Right. Because and that person, and he'll tell you, that person's not going to get help unless they want help. I've seen family members threaten, throw the person out of the house and take them to a clinic, and if that person doesn't want to get the help, it's not going to work.
Yeah, that's true. That's
yeah, and couldn't agree with more. We see people, we work with people every single day like this. They go to the right classes, we're teaching them what their triggers might be, we're educating them. But if they don't have that self-motivation, they don't have that internal motivation, that's something we really can't do.
You can't
then sometimes the what we do really doesn't get through, unfortunately. But then you get those opportunities when you get somebody who's like kind of had it, and they're ready, and they're really ready, they're internally motivated, they're listening, they're like a sponge. They sit there and will just listen to everything they need to learn about their disease to keep it at arm's reach, because there's no cure. There's no cure for the disease of addiction.
There's okay. No medicine to take to cure your drug or alcohol addiction,
right.
Or any addiction, whether it's internet addiction now or whatever. There's no drug to say, well, here, just take this once a day and you're fine.
Well, there are drugs out that they take.
Right.
But it's transferring the addiction from the illegal drug to a prescribed drug.
Yeah,
right.
And so they're taking that daily so they don't go to the illegal drug.
Right. And that's medically assisted treatment medications. Some are oral tablets. A lot of the companies are going to a monthly shot. Mm-hmm. Instead of having to go somewhere and taking a tablet every day, or because sometimes you've got a tablet, they can sell. Some people can, if they want to start using again, they will go out and start selling that drug because that's not their drug of choice. But it'll get good market value on the street. They'll get that money, then they'll go out and buy their drug of choice. So a lot of pharmaceutical companies, I think, a little arm twisting by the government too. They want to go to just give them monthly injections. So that's where that industry's going there.
Hopefully that helps, because we have to
do
better than we've been doing as a society for the people that have this disease. If someone has cancer, we're like, you're all in and everyone's helping them. And unfortunately, most society is they're an addict. That's their problem.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not. It's everybody's problem.
Once an addict, always an addict. That old adage, that's not true anymore. It's really not true anymore, and that's part of the education that we, whenever we get a chance to talk to family members or physicians or nurses, anyone else in healthcare, that's not true anymore.
And I think an important point too is people don't know that they have an addictive personality. When they take a drug or take a drink, they don't know that that's going to cause an addiction. So.
Right.
It only is when they take the drug or the drink and they become addicted, that's how you know.
And then it's too late.
Then it's too late.
That's it.
I think now society is more acceptance of helping addicts, the 70s, 80s, and part of the 90s, that's their problem. They'll be on Skid Row, don't worry about them. But
they've had programs on Skid Row. They've had needle exchanges where they've gone down and given them fresh needles to use. Yeah. With their drugs, instead of reusing the needles and passing it around and everybody getting hepatitis. And they've had these programs, but the education is not there, and we need to do that.
Yeah. So there's a lot of stigma still out there in our society, not only against addicts, but people who suffer from mental health
issues. Exactly.
And that's not being addressed.
If we kind of, we always did these series, but it was always, you had to come in person. And you'd offer, like you said, the mental health, and you'd get maybe two people. no, you know, we did it, and we're like, hey, we got 600 views on Facebook, and it's growing. And that's a great feeling, is, you know, so we're helping society more, because that stigmatism, I'm not going in there, because then they're going to go, oh, he's crazy or she's crazy. And it's not necessarily true. And some people are recovering addicts or private people. They don't want to go into a, you know, a public place for an educational seminar and have everyone know they're addicted.
What we talked about earlier with the pandemic, a lot of mental health issues came to the spotlight with everyday people, and that stigma has started to dissipate when you realize that a lot of people struggled in the past 2 years, you know, both socially, employment-wise, and mental health issues that they were able to mask or carry on with and not let people know. They were finally seeking treatment for, which is wonderful. Sure. And to your point, with people maybe not being comfortable meeting face-to-face from a mental health aspect, I don't know about rehabilitation, but having therapy appointments over the computer, over the phone, there's now apps that you can text when you're struggling with something and speak to a counselor. So there's different platforms now to accommodate people's comfort level with outreach.
Well, in Simone, I can't think of her last name, the gymnast. Yes. I think that helped a lot. Yeah, that helped a lot. Michael Phelps coming out and saying, hey, I suffer from depression. It's breaking barriers down. That breaks barriers down quicker than anything, you know.
Right. And what, sitting here next to, I would never have known.
Right.
There's no outward sign that you have that says, I'm an addict. It could be anybody that you're with at any time could be an addict, and you don't know that.
Right.
Or same thing with mental health. There's could be anybody that has an issue.
If you look at the number one reason, I've read almost every study I can get my hands on, the number one reason why people don't seek help for substance abuse or for mental health, stigma. It's what people people say about them when they are in the grocery store. It's what they think, how people are going to look at them.
And
it's why we got to address that.
But society's evolving to make it more acceptable. Like I said, when I was a kid, it was like, he wasted his life. Don't worry about him. That's what he's going to be. That was the 70s, you know. Now it's like, we need to help this person. Mm-hmm. This is another human being. We all bleed red, you know.
Right.
So, well, thank you, gentlemen. One takeaway or one aspect you think could really help, besides education? Got a candy?
That's the big one. Educate people on addiction. And once we start doing that, I think that will help overall the society.
Okay.
The one thing I'd like to point out there is that there is help out there if you just think you're suffering from substance abuse, and I'd like to let them know that there is hope out there, and recovery works. People do get well.
Yeah, case in point, I would have never guessed.
I'd say awareness from societal standpoint and family standpoint that it can be a real struggle having a family member struggling with addiction, but knowing the right things to say and doing some research on your own, it's not just up to that addict to find help themselves.
And I'm assuming they could call the hospital or Gateway Rehab to get pointed in the right direction, or even our police department, or there's a lot of choices out there to just call someone and say, hey, my family member needs help, or I need help.
Yeah, even Gateway, we just started, we're 24 hours now, and you can call anytime, day or night.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
Help. That's a great thing.
Yeah, it is. Well, thank you, gentlemen. This wraps up our Live Well series for the 2021-2022 series. We thank Bethel Park and everyone for tuning in, and we'll see you in the fall. Thank you.